The John LeBanks Show has been known to make people laugh, sing, think, scream, throw things in rage, and generally lose their minds. Listener discretion is advised. All right, welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. And now, as you all look forward to each and every month, we bring back our good friend, Mr. Derek Shelmerdine, for our special little segment called Rock and Roll Unraveled. Derek, how are you this fine day?
It's actually raining a little here, but apart from that, it's a very, very beautiful day. And it's great to be back with you, John. Okay, well, I mean, start with one of the biggest rock and roll bands in the history of the world, the Rolling Stones. A couple of birthdays. On the 18th of July 1938, Ian Stewart was born. Now, if people haven't heard of Ian Stewart, he was actually the first person to join Brian Jones's band that eventually became the Rolling Stones. And he was there before Happy Birthday Mick Jagger. He was born on the 26th of July 1943. And the Stones, under that name, played their first ever gig on the 12th of July 1962. What happened is they were substituting for Alexis Corner. Mick Jagger was his lead vocalist at the time. He was also in the Brian Jones Rolling Stones band. And Corner had a gig elsewhere. But there was Brian Jones, Mick Jagger and Keith Richard there. Dick Taylor, the bass player, went on to form Pretty Things. But the jury's out on who the drummer was that day. If you go to the Rolling Stones website, they say that it was Mick Avery, the Kinks drummer. But if you go to Cast Off Kinks, which is actually a website associated with people who used to be in the Kinks. There's an interesting interview with Mick Avery, and he says he never actually played at that gig. He rehearsed with them, but never actually played that gig.
And it was the guy Tony Chapman that he was talking about?
Right, well, the other guy that was most likely to have been the drummer was Tony Chapman. He was in a group called the Cliftons, and that was the group that bass player came from. The Rolling Stones were just sort of starting out, and I mean, the Stones had a lot of different people through the bass and through the drums at the time.
Good piece of history.
Absolutely. And going on to the 28th of July 66, that was the last time American fans saw Brian Jones. He played his last ever gig in Honolulu. And interestingly enough, on the 5th of July 69, the Stones played their first gig with Mick Taylor. Because Brian Jones had been sacked from the Stones 2 or 3 weeks earlier. A couple of days before the gig at Hyde Park, Brian Jones had died on the 3rd of July 1969. He was just 27 years old. He died in mysterious circumstances in a swimming pool of his house. And on the same day, 2 weeks later, 3rd of July 1971, Jim Morrison, Lizard King, and Doors front man, he died at the age of 27. And that's where the whole sort of 27 Club comes about. Lots of people, Janis Joplin, legends, died on the 27th. And in 1938, Robert Johnson, the famous blues guy, died on the 16th of August. And it's generally felt that he'd sold his soul to the devil, the crossroads, for fame and fortune.
Yeah, that's been the myth behind that 27-year-old death concept, right?
I mean, I've seen some people suggest that famous jazz musicians had died at the age of 27 before that. But I think they're fitting that into the legend, as it were. And I think Robert Johnson's a good place to start that particular conversation.
Well, you and I made it past 27, so we're good.
Exactly. Yes, yes. It's always good to move on. We all think we're going to die before we're 40. Never happens. Well, it sometimes happens. Doesn't always. Singles, good day for some singles for the Stones. First of August 64, they had their first US hit with Tell Me, entered the Billboard chart on that day, 1st of August. And on the 18th of August 67, in the UK, they released We Love You, coupled with Dandelion. Now, Dandelion was the hit in America, but We Love You was the A-side in the UK. And John Lennon and Paul McCartney sang backing vocals on that particular song. A little bit of trivia. And Mick Jagger's first movie performance was released on the 3rd of August 1970. Described in the posters as madness, sanity, fantasy, reality, sensuality, death, life, vice versa.
That's a little bit of a title there, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. I mean, well, the time of the film itself, I didn't say that, did I? The time of the film itself was performance. And it was just, that was the way the posters described the film. But you're right. I mean, that would have made one heck of a title. Stones are on tour at the moment. They're doing a European tour called the No Filler Tour. And that goes across Europe, basically. Germany, Austria, Switzerland, Italy, and a bunch of other places. And if you're in Europe from the 9th of September to the 25th of October, you can catch them. And I dare say they'll be playing a lot of stuff from their new album, Blue and Lonesome, which is the Stones going back to their roots. And it's a great album.
Just to touch on the Paul McCartney and John Lennon singing backups, I remember as when I was a youth, there was always a separation in fans. It was either the Beatles were great or the Rolling Stones were great. And who would have thought that they actually collaborated on something?
Brian Jones actually plays sax as well on, I think it's the B-side of, I think it's a track called You Know My Name, Call the Number or something like that. But the reason they played it was that the Stones had just been done for a drugs bust in the UK. And the Beatles, well, John and Paul were showing solidarity, because the Who actually released a single as well of a couple of Jagger Richard compositions, Under My Thumb, and another one I can't quite remember the name of offhand. So they were all showing solidarity to the Stones. But you're right, I mean, it was all very much, are you a Beatles man or are you a Stones man at the time?
That's cool stuff. Now we got Cream to talk about as well, right?
Oh, absolutely. One of my all-time favorite bands. I mean, they made their official debut gig on the 31st of July 1966 at the 6th National Jazz and Blues Festival in Windsor, just outside London. Yeah, what happened? Eric Clapton left John Mayall. They just released Blues Breakers with Eric Clapton. Ginger Baker had recently left Graham Bond Organization. And Jack Bruce had been with Manfred Mann, surprisingly enough. He was only with them a short time, but they released Pretty Flamingo while he was there. And they were together for, I mean, Cream was together for just over a couple of years, and then they all parted company at the end of 1968. And at the beginning of 1969, Blind Faith was pulled together by Eric Clapton. They, actually, strange band. I mean, they played their final gig at the in Hawaii on the 24th of August, 1969. They'd only been together for a few months. I mean, they actually played the first gig and only gig in the UK back in early June. What happened was Clapton went on then to play with Delaney and Bonnie, who'd supported the Blind Faith American tour. And it was basically a bunch of Delaney and Bonnie friends, as they call themselves, who made up the band for Derek and the Dominoes. August 1969, on the 29th, Jack Bruce released his first album, solo album, after splitting from Cream, called Songs for a... Now, the tailor in the title is a lady called Jeannie Franklin, also known as Jeannie the Tailor, and she was a designer and used to make clothes for lots of bands, including the Cream, and she died when the tour bus that Fairport Convention were in, back in a few months earlier in May, that crashed on the way back from a gig, and she died in that. She was in the van. She was the guitarist Richard Thompson's girlfriend. But sadly, Martin Lamble, the drummer, actually also died in that particular crash. Hmm. And the last thing really on sort of history side for Cream was that on the 19th of August 1939, Ginger Baker was born. So happy birthday, Ginger Baker. He was in Cream and Blind Faith. Went on to form his own band, Ginger Baker's Air Force. Brilliant band. And Eric Clapton's on tour at the moment. You can catch him at Madison Square Garden in New York on September the 7th and 8th, and the Forum, Inglewood, California, on September the 15th and 16th.
So it's just a four-show tour.
Yeah, I think he's sort of dipping in and out of these things. He's on the road sporadically, as it were. There might well still be opportunity to get tickets for those gigs in September, and he would be a great guy to catch in concert. Sadly, we won't see Jack Bruce in concert anymore, and Ginger Baker's not a well man now. I did come across a tour. It's not actually going on at the moment, but recently finished with Ginger Baker's son, Jack Bruce's son, and I think it was Clapton's cousin. Doing a Cream tribute tour.
You brought up Eric Clapton had a final show in Hawaii, and then the Stones also had what was it, Brian Jones, right? Had his final show in Honolulu, Hawaii. Is that like a resting place for people?
Yeah, it does seem like the kiss of death to play Hawaii. Lovely place it is. Maybe more for surfers and rock and roll bands. But yeah, it's an interesting coincidence then.
Now sit your butt down.
John LeBanchon will be right back.
And I promise you'll love it. Yes. And I'd like to welcome our new sponsor, Pane in the Glass, commercial and residential window cleaning. For a beautiful, sparkling shine that's crystal clear, call Pane in the Glass Window Cleaning. You can find them on Facebook at Pane in the Glass. So we got Frank Zappa and some news on him, right?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, he's got some interesting links to the Animals, Led Zeppelin, and Grand Funk Railroad, to mention just a few. Now, the Animals, on the 4th of July, 1966, the Animals were recording their Animalism session with Frank Zappa. He arranged a couple of songs on it, one of his own songs, All Night Long, and the Fred Neil classic, The Other Side of This Life. Zappa's reputed to have played guitar on All Night Long, and probably bass on The Other Side of This Life. But that was, I mean, where are we now? 1966, July 4. This is the very end of the Animals era. They split up shortly after. And, of course, Chas Chandler saw Jimi Hendrix at the Café Noir in New York, and he became Jimi Hendrix's manager. Took him to the UK, and, well, Jimi Hendrix was born, basically. Jimi Hendrix Experience. I mean, they split up at the Electric Ladyland. They parted company.
And that was a good album, too.
Oh, that was a great album. Yeah, it was really good. I mean, those first three albums, well, all his albums are pretty awesome, but those first three were unbelievable. And you've got to remember at the time, you know, the 1966, 67, 68, there was nothing like it before. So it was all real groundbreaking stuff. But I think one of the real fun Frank Zappa associations is with Led Zeppelin, 28th of July 1969, the notorious Edgewater Inn mud shark incident. I mean, that was an interesting one. Led Zeppelin were playing at the Seattle Pop Festival, and they were staying in a hotel called the Edgewater Inn. It's actually built on a pier, and you're encouraged to fish out of the windows. They've actually got a fishing tackle shop in the hotel. And the roadies were there in the afternoon. They caught a few mud sharks. Now, as one does, the evening was a mixture of groupies. And mud sharks as makeshift sex toys.
No way. No way. Sex? They were using mud sharks as sex toys?
Yeah, apparently that's the way the myth goes. And if you listen to Zappa Connection, is on his album Fillmore East, June of 1971, he's got a track called The Mud Shark, and he talks about this, and he says that it was filmed by Vanilla Fudge. It was also at the Seattle Pop Festival, so it must be true. I've never actually seen anybody who's actually seen the film, wow, that's got to be one of rock and roll's après rock and roll favorites.
Oh, that's great. That's just an awesome story. One of the best you brought to the show.
I think of that particular one. Frank Zappa himself, on the 1st of August 64, he opened his first studio in Cucamonga, and that's when he started working with people like Captain Beefheart, and he did a lot of doo-wop there, a lot of which sort of turned up on his later albums. And 1969, 20th of August, he disbanded the original Mothers of Invention. Now, they'd sort of got together back in the mid-65, when they renamed from the Soul Giants. And they had five or classic albums, Freak Out, Absolutely Free, We're Only Here for the Money, Lumpy Gravy, and Cruising with Reuben and the Jets, which is Zappa's tribute to doo-wop. I mean, fabulous albums.
Hmm.
And a great time that, right across the 60s.
Yeah, Frank Zappa had probably the most original ideas when it came to songs outside of maybe Pink Floyd.
Absolutely. I think he's one of my personal favorites, Frank Zappa. And his albums are all just so different. And what he decided that he didn't want the expense of keeping a band full-time on the payroll because they were, I guess, they were starting to tour a bit less. And they split up shortly after a short tour of Canada, I seem to remember.
Well, at least it wasn't in Hawaii.
Absolutely. Yeah, I'll have to look out for more bands who were terminate their careers in Hawaii. There must be a bunch of them out there. But, I mean, one of the bands to come from Michigan, Flint, was Grand Funk Railroad. And on the 9th of August, 1976, they released an album called Good Singing, Good Playing. And that was produced by Frank Zappa. What happened is they'd disbanded shortly before, got together to work with Zappa, and they disbanded again shortly after. Because, I mean, Grand Funk Railroad was sort of coming together, and after that as well, throughout the sort of 80s and 90s, they were sort of coming back together. They were driven really by Mark Farner was on the driving forces, came from Terry Knight and the Pack. And he put the band together originally with a guy called Don Brewer on drums and Mel Shaker on bass. And the tour now, what happened was they eventually split up with Farner. He eventually went his own way. But they got together with Max Carl on vocals, Bruce Kulnick on guitar, and Tom Cashin on keyboards, and they've been touring since around 2000, and they're on the road right now, and you can catch them right up now till the 16th of March 2018, right across America.
We don't have many homeboys from Michigan anymore, and Kid Rock's going to run for a political seat now, so we won't even have him.
So I mean, when you think of Sonny Bono, I mean, he did quite well out of politics as well. Some of the most unlikely people sometimes.
Yeah, he had the smile for it.
Absolutely. I liked his singles. I was one of the people who really enjoyed this couple of solo singles in the mid-60s. But Eric Burdon, talking of, as we were earlier, the Animals, Parting Company in mid-66. I mean, Eric Burdon has carried on since. He worked with War for a while, and he's on tour right now. It's Switzerland and the USA. From the 3rd of September through to the 24th of November. It's a lot of the gigs are being billed as Eric Burdon and the Animals, because when the Animals did split up in 66, he formed the New Animals and kept the name alive for a while before he got together with War.
So we got Queen next. Is that true? Queen?
Queen, absolutely. Queen is still going strong. Well, sort of going strong. They're not all there, of course. But, I mean, Freddie Mercury... before Cream was formed, he played his first gig with one of his earlier bands called Ibex. So that was on the 23rd of August 1969. A couple of weeks later, he played with Brian May and Roger Taylor for the first time. He was playing at with his band Ibex at a gig at the Sync Club, famous club in Liverpool. And he knew Brian May and Roger Taylor. And for the encore, they got up on stage and played with him, so jammed along. So that was the first time that those three guys got together. And in fact, on the 2nd of July 1971, it was when the classic lineup finally came together at Surrey College, and John Deacon replaced the original bass player Mike Gross. So it was a good time, really. I mean, the first gig had been back in June 1970s, so Queen had quite a long gestation before they actually released their first album. I mean, they didn't release their first album called Queen until the 13th of August 1973. So essentially 3 years after the first gig, so no overnight sensation.
Yeah, but that first album was so good. They probably, especially knowing Freddie Mercury, they probably spent a lot of time writing those songs because, I mean, you could tell he... especially with his harmonies and stuff like that, he really thought out the song process.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. And it's good, really, I think, when bands do take a while and pull it together. I mean, the Record Collector magazine in the UK, it's the Under Goldmine in the States for years. I mean, almost every year, I think, since it started, the Beatles have been the most collectible, voted the most collectible band, but an awful lot of the time Queen were voted as the second most collectible band in the UK in that particular magazine. I mean, a very, very highly rated band. I mean, just before I move on to the tour, happy birthday, Brian May, born on the 19th of July, 1947. And you can actually catch Queen on tour now, shortly, with vocalist Adam Lambert. And they're on tour from the 31st of July to the 16th of December across USA, Europe, and the UK. So plenty of chance to catch them.
Yeah, that's fairly extensive, actually. For half a year, you're basically touring, and you're getting a chance to see Queen. That's pretty good.
Absolutely. I mean, they got together with vocalist Adam Lambert in 2014, and they're on tour with him again now.
Now, did they put out an album with him?
I'm not sure. I'm not aware of one, but they might have done. I need to check that.
No worries. I always throw something weird at you.
But, I mean, if the first guy that's... not really replaced Freddie Mercury, but went on the road with Queen as their lead singer, of course, was Paul Rodgers from Free and Bad Company.
One of the best vocalists ever.
Absolutely.
He's one of those steady vocalists. You knew his voice right from the beginning. It didn't matter what group you heard him in, if he was solo, if he was with Bad Company. It didn't matter. You knew Paul Rodgers' voice, and it was steady throughout the years. It really, you could just tell who it was.
No, absolutely. I mean, they're two of my favorite bands. I mean, Free in the 60s and Bad Company in the 70s. Fantastic. Really powerful stuff.
So, Derek, why don't you give everybody some information about you, where they can contact you, where they can check out your stuff.
Great, yeah. I wrote a book called Rock and Roll Unraveled, and all of the information virtually that we talked about for the last few minutes comes from that particular book, and that's available on Amazon. And a good place to find lots of information is on my website, www.rockandrollunravel.com. And I'm very active on Facebook and Twitter. You can catch that from the website. So if you're interested in rock and roll, the book tells a story of rock and roll from its roots back in the Robert Johnson days through to punk in the mid-70s. It's absolutely jam-packed full of information, the kind of thing we've been chatting about today.
Well, Derek, I want to thank you again for coming on. I appreciate it. I look forward to our next installment, which will be right at the end of next month, beginning of September.
Great to talk to you again. I really enjoy these chats.
Thank you so much for coming on, and we'll see you next month.
My pleasure. Cheers, John.
If you want to contact the John LeBang Show, feel free to send an email to jlebang@live.com. And if you're on Twitter, look him up at John LeBang. And don't forget to go to his Facebook page at The John LeBang Show.